Yes.
It works.
It works.
Yes. So we are live with someone who probably doesn't need an introduction.
Barry Courter.
And David Carroll from good old Channel 3 and WFLI,
yes.
Where we are right now.
We are.
You have a lot of history here. A lot of people have a lot of history here, and we're going to be talking with them today because it is a big day, the last day here.
WFLI signing off after 56 years at 1070 on the AM dial. 56 years.
Can you turn around?
Sure.
Are you comfortable turning around? Look at that.
Oh.
Look at that. What's that word?
Very cool.
I think it's the only one that still exists. It's from the 60s, and Rick Sharp, who's right outside the window there, gave this to me a few years ago, and it was the first time I've worn it. I thought it was a nice little museum piece to wear today.
Very much.
So this building is full of people.
Mm-hmm.
Full of memories.
Full of memories. We're here to tell a few. I remember Jett Fly. I remember the lights in the sky. I remember the fastest jet in the sky. I mean, Jett Fly was big time.
Well, and, you know, you and I remember a lot of things. Leslie, being 23, has no idea what we're talking about.
Yeah.
So let me explain this to you, Leslie.
Thank you.
Growing up in the 60s and 70s, AM radio was all you had, really. There were a few FM stations around, but AM dominated. And this was when music was really getting good. Rock and roll had come along, you had the Beatles, the Stones, the Supremes.
I know them.
The British Invasion, Motown, Mamas and the Papas, all these people. It was just a great creative time for music. And it was just the perfect storm. WFLI signed on the year 1961. It had 10,000 watts, which was a lot of power. Later increased to 50,000 watts, which is a ginormous amount of power. So it dominated the teen market at a time when rock and roll was really coming alive.
So cool.
And all these, and you know, my kids, for example, are in their 20s, and they grew up listening to the same songs I grew up listening to because it has such a great staying power. So the personalities who are on WFLI, many of them who are here in the building today, are pretty much provided the soundtrack to our generation.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sitting here thinking as you're talking, WKRP, movies that you know, feature that era.
Yeah. American Graffiti.
This is what it was like here, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it was, DJs were rock stars. They were as popular, as well known in the communities as the artists that would come. I know I've seen and heard stories of like Tommy Jett introducing some of the spectacular bands. And
let me tell Leslie about the spectacular.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm liking all this visuals coming.
Here's
my
the
mind.
Thing. Imagine, Leslie, that you heard an announcement for a concert coming to Chattanooga next month.
I'm imagining.
With Usher, Katy Perry.
Okay.
Let's say
One Direction,
Ed Sheeran, One Direction.
Oh, I love Ed Sheeran.
You know, think of the five or six biggest acts in the business right now. Adele. I mean, all of them coming to Chattanooga the same night.
Very cool.
On the same stage. And admission, $5.
No.
Yeah. See, that's not going to happen.
No. Yeah.
But back in the 60s and early 70s here, the hottest acts, all the acts who were on Billboard's top 10, came to Memorial Auditorium twice
a
year on one stage. Admission $2.50.
Oh my gosh!
And the station sponsored that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
so
awesome.
It's just kind of
the
like mind blowing.
Was on one of those bills, right?
Herman's, Paul Revere and the Raiders.
All on the same bill.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So that's the impact the station had.
Wow.
Yeah.
So do you remember some like rock star stories? Were you kind of a rock star here, in DC?
Was I? No, I wasn't a rock star.
Probably was.
I came along a little late. I was here. I was a teenager, but growing up, this was the station that I idolized. It was
so
like,
cool.
Can I, you know, if what could be better than being on the air at JetFly? And I would be at home like lots of other kids, playing records, pretending I was on the radio. And so when I was 18, that came true. I got to be here and worked a year and a half here. And by that time, Tommy Jett, some of the legends of the 60s had already moved on to other stations. But it was like a dream come true for me to be sitting in the same chair, you know, talking with the same microphone, playing with these same dials that all these guys I've grown up idolizing.
Hey, Davey, I'm going to have to take your seat for a couple
minutes. Paul's got to do something here for a second.
Y'all can have it back.
Let's watch. Let's see
what you're doing.
Something's happening here. What's happening?
Okay.
What are we doing?
I can tell you what's happening.
Okay.
Hold on.
Paul White runs
you
the place.
See, you See that little thing up there that says 5642?
I see it.
Well, at 5933, it stops.
Oh, my goodness.
There ain't nothing there.
You hear that?
So we don't, you can't sell silence on radio.
No.
Nobody will pay for a silent radio. So we're going to make sure it don't go silent.
Okay.
No,
all right,
important.
Good deal.
Did somebody
turn,
put my CD in?
I didn't touch it, I swear.
I didn't touch it.
Cable,
it's okay. The player was off. I believe Cable's not.
Oh, come on now.
Problem.
I do.
Back off.
He's got a guilty face.
He does.
David Carroll was the one in the chair.
That's yeah. Right, yeah.
He did there turn. He did turn around.
Oh, look at the back.
Now I know it's ready.
You want to let David song. Push the button for you?
No.
Oh,
come on, Paul.
See if David no. Can remember what he was doing.
I spent a year and a half here saying, what does this button do?
Yeah.
Suspense.
We're gonna
be back on.
So, Paul.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you sad today?
I'm not what?
Are you sad? Is this a sad day?
He's never sad,
is this a
no.
Happy day? Or
what? I'll answer that question after I get it changed.
Okay, so, I understand. We understand,
you know, where
all the technical
from?
Stuff.
Well,
it doesn't look like much has changed around here, does it, Ellis? Like, it
remember
looks like it's kind of.
No.
Stood the test of time. Yes?
I started in radio
yeah.
In 1954.
1954? What was
going on
back then?
I've been in it all my life.
Wow.
I'll be 79 in September. I don't think it's a shame.
You don't? he's fine. He's good with it. That's a good attitude, Paul.
Oh, yeah.
Well, what was happening in 1954?
Yeah, here? What was happening?
Yeah, what was happening?
Back then, I was at a small station.
Okay.
And did block programming.
Block programming.
By that, you sign on in the morning.
He's got to do something. So... Yeah, so he's
happy.
You start
in the morning with country music, in the middle of the day you play easy listening music, and then you got into a little pop music, and then back to country, and at nighttime it was dance music.
Well, that sounds fun. So Paul was just saying, maybe you didn't hear, block programming, when he started, was they switched the blocks, essentially, of like country, easy listening, pop, and that doesn't really happen now. Stations are just kind of married to one thing, you know. So I think that's kind of cool. But Paul is... I was mentioning, he's happy with today, he's good with where his career is, and he's going to talk to us in a couple minutes. DC, you want to join us? You want to come back? Anybody want to come back? Well, all right. For me, I want to hear some more stories, which I'm sure you guys do too, about if you don't know who Tommy Jett is, he is a character, so I hope he's going to come in here soon, and a lot of other people who have worked here, and I'm sure they have stories. I want to hear, like, the really good stories that we, you know, like the R-rated ones, maybe. Don't you? Like with the rock stars? I do. That's what I want to know. I'm not going to hear it. There have to be some, right? Never.
It has to be someone.
I want to hear like the R-rated stories of all these rock stars.
Hey, listen. Yeah. The station has been Southern Gospel since 1981.
Oh, I want to know.
I don't
before.
Have any R-rated stories. I'm sorry about that.
What happened before the Southern Gospel came?
It was country for 2 years, about in 61 up until then it was run on all hard rock.
I believe so.
I want to know back in the hard rock days, but
you'll have to talk to David Carroll. I don't know.
He won't tell me
that.
Anything.
I'm sorry. There's my bodyguard.
Oh, it's your bodyguard?
That's my oldest son.
Hey.
And my grandson.
Hi. I'm sure they're very
proud
of you.
For
what? Yeah. For what? Yeah. So did you do what you're supposed to be doing over here?
Yeah. I'm through. I've played this one, and now
okay.
y'all can have it back. All
that's
right.
That's what happened.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul.
You're more than welcome.
Well, that was fun.
You got to see the magic happening.
It was magical. Yes.
Now, David, you did tell them what you had to do before these things came around.
Somebody's going to have to tell us what that is.
You may have to tell them.
What is
that? That's a cart, what they call a cart. That's where you put your commercial.
Oh.
You wander down with it, David.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh.
Before, back when I started, okay,
yes.
If a client bought a schedule of 10 commercials a day for 5 days, that's 50 spots, okay?
Okay.
You had to read it every time you did it.
Oh.
So after the first day, you knew it by heart. You didn't have to read it. You could just sit there and tell them. And that's what the boss wanted.
Okay.
Just sit and sell them. Don't tell them. Sell them.
Sell them.
Yep.
Okay.
And it was very easy to do after that first day when you'd read the darn thing, but it was in a file, just like you took to school with you, except they were alphabetized.
Yeah.
So while your record's playing, you look up your commercials real quick for the next break.
Wow. So it got down to a science.
Yeah, but now then it's down to this.
Down
and
to
this
that.
Is what we did
oh, cool.
prior to tape.
What is that, Max?
Cool.
This came over on Noah's Ark.
Yep. Let's see, I don't think it worked out because I don't think there's a needle in it.
No, we don't have a needle in it.
No, there's not
a needle.
Very cool.
Okay, got that out of the way.
When I came here, we were playing 45s.
Awesome.
Yeah, but now look, wait a minute. They've got it covered up.
Yeah,
that lets you play the 45.
Oh, wow.
That's the thing that pops up through there and put your 45 on there.
But don't put a CD on there.
No.
Also, you can put it on there, but it won't hear anything.
Very cool. So, what's going to happen to this place?
It's for sale.
It's for sale?
Yeah.
Just gonna go dark.
The boss lady is, that's her you're here talking, and she hasn't been able to find a buyer, and she's retiring, so.
Well, is anything going to happen with some of this equipment? I feel like it should be preserved.
Only she can answer
that.
Yeah.
That would be cool.
As far as I know, there's nothing. Yeah.
We were hoping we'd all get a door prize.
The drawing's been waiting. That's why I'm wearing this coat. I'll tuck something under it when I go home.
You need a basket.
All right, you guys, I want to hear some more stories.
Yes.
Who's coming back to talk to me? Thanks, Paul.
Let's get David to tell a few more.
I'm back. David, you can have a seat back.
Paul, good to see you.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
You're more than welcome.
Well, that was fun.
Paul's a great guy.
So I was just saying, as I was talking to Paul, the station has been Southern Gospel since 81. They're messing with the dials back here. Good job.
How does he know that and I don't?
Oh.
He's a techie.
Yeah.
I watched him. All right, but
so
I do want to say real quick,
what
we were hearing over there is
people
can hear it's on right now, 1070. It's
okay.
Like three hours. Special with a lot of these memories, kind of what we're talking about.
Oh, cool.
So, not to send people away from us, listen to it later.
Yeah, Barry.
But do listen to it.
David, best memory.
Yeah, I want to go back to the fun times.
Well, okay. And you were asking for R-rated stuff.
Yeah.
I can't give you R-rated stuff.
Like PG-13?
Yeah, I can tell you a couple things that I think are kind of funny. the transmitter next door here is very intimidating because it's a unique, old, hand-built 50,000-watt transmitter. And when I started working here, I was 18, and I had never changed a light bulb. And you have to pass a test to get a radio license, but the one that I passed was very basic. I was never an engineer. It was just memory stuff, and I could do that. So I knew nothing about technology, and obviously from the fact that I couldn't turn on the monitor while I still
don't. The talkers don't really know.
I was a talker, and not a particularly good one at that.
Right here.
But every hour, you're supposed to go in there and take the meter readings, and it was very complicated, especially for an 18-year-old kid like me. And I was very intimidated by it because it was just kind of scary looking. You had a lot of big switches and knobs and buttons, and it would pop and boom and bang when you change power.
Mm-hmm.
I just like to stay away from it.
Yeah,
so I would come in at the beginning of my shift at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I would take the hourly readings all at one time, so I'd never have to go back in there. In other words, I would cheat. If the FCC is watching, go ahead, lock me up. It was 30 years ago. What are you going to do? Right? So I got away with
that.
Well, it was expedient. And I got away with that for about a year. And then one day, the owner of the station, Mr. Benz, came in. And he was an older gentleman. And he came in on a Friday. He was always in a bad mood on Friday because that's the day he had to sign our paychecks. We were in a good mood only on Fridays because we got a paycheck.
Right.
So he wanders in here one day with his dog, a big German Shepherd. Again, very intimidating. And I'm sitting here, 18 years old. And he comes in and looks at the clipboard where the meter readings are kept, and he sees it's about 2:30. And he looks at it and says, the readings for 3 o'clock are done, the readings for 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. And so, And he looked at me and said, Mr. Carroll, can you see the future? Can you yes. predict the future?
Exactly.
And I'm sitting here, you know, like, no, sir. Well, if this, you know, this can't ever happen again, right, King? And he looked at his dog. You know, his dog barked at me and everything. So never did that again. But he was also, he had a tendency to be, how do I put this? Sometimes he, how should I put it, Bill, about, okay, I just did, didn't I, when I did that?
Oh, he was a little.
I didn't say anything.
He was a social person.
He liked his milk.
And so he had a tendency to fire people on the spur of the moment. But he would forget that he fired them, and they come back the next day, and it was all forgotten. And I always thought that you just always come back, no matter what.
Just keep showing up.
Yeah.
So Bill, for example, may have been fired several times. I don't know, but he always came back.
At least one, I remember.
Is this gentleman still around?
No,
he passed away a few years ago, and he was. And I'm making him sound terrible.
I think he sounds fun.
He was a genius. He was the guy who built that transmitter, put the station on the air. And he passed away several years ago, and I think he was in his 80s. But he was the guy who's responsible for all this, Mr. Benz.
He sounds very colorful.
That's well put.
Yeah.
You have done a great job of gathering a lot of these in your book.
Thank you.
Yes.
Tell people where they can get it and what it's called, because a lot of these stories are in there. They're very funny, and you've kept this alive. So thank you for doing that.
Well, thank you, Barry, for saying that.
That's really cool.
I have two books, Chattanooga Radio and Television and Volunteer Bama Dog. All the good titles were taken. I tried to get Gone with the Wind. Somebody used that one. And they're at ChattanoogaRadioTV.com and at Wally's in East Ridge.
But I
did enjoy putting the radio TV
great.
Stories
good stuff.
She's still going to Wally's?
All right,
sure.
We got Mr. Eagle.
Johnny Eagle.
Thank you, David.
The man who put it on
Thanks,
the air.
CC.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Love you.
Thank you, David.
Barry, thanks
Always
for having me.
Always a pleasure, brother.
So long.
Take care of that
David,
jacket.
Great job, brother. Thank great you. Job.
Please have a seat, sir.
Johnny, you're next in the barrel, buddy.
The man. Next in the barrel.
Holy moly.
The legend.
The man. Now, he's the one that probably has the stories.
Oh, yeah. I want to hear some good stories about this place. Some really juicy ones. Can you tell me some?
Yeah, Johnny.
Okay.
You got four or five.
Ask him about the 5 million bottle caps that are in the driveway out there. That's one thing.
Okay.
That's not to bury.
Bottle caps.
All right, well, the station had a contest with Royal Crown Cola, RC.
Okay.
You ever had an RC?
I have.
And a moon pie, I got to.
And a moon pie, yeah.
How do you live here?
Anyway, the contest was with schools, and the school that collected the most bottle caps got tickets to one of our JetFly spectaculars.
Okay.
The entire student body.
Oh, fun.
I don't remember which school won, but that encompassed around 2,500 students. Anyway, we had no place to put the bottle caps. And when it was all over with, there were millions of bottle caps. Because those kids really went after getting bottle caps.
So,
I don't know whose idea it was, but they were going to pave the parking lot. So, we put underneath all that pavement out there, millions of RC bottle caps.
That's really cool.
A solution.
Love
family.
That story. Very cool.
David and I were trying to tell Leslie about the spectaculars. What were those like?
Yeah.
You were there.
Those were probably the most fun that I had here at the radio station.
What happened? What went on?
Well, the first show we put on had 9 acts. You ever been to a concert in an auditorium with 9 acts?
Never in an auditorium. The only thing I can compare it to is like festivals.
Yeah.
But not in an auditorium.
Yeah. Well, we had 9 acts on the first show. We had no idea. The show was never, they were never meant to make money. They were meant
for the people.
For the people. Right.
Awesome.
And to
station promotion.
Station promotion. But of all the shows we put them on, and we went from 1965 to 1972. And there was only one that lost money out of all of them, even though the ticket prices were $2.50 and $3.
Can you imagine?
So,
now it'd be like $300 or more.
The first show we put on was in March 19th, 1965. And those 9 acts, and all the tickets were sold except for about 1,000 or 1,500 prior to show. Chattanooga is notorious for walk-up.
Definitely.
Even back then.
Yeah. Okay. Even back then. Anyway, When the doors opened, the people came in, and before we knew it, it was sold out. And according to the officials at that time, we turned away over 2,000 people to go to that show. Well, a gentleman by the name of Redding ran the Martin Theaters downtown at that time. And he called me up on Monday morning and said, I want to thank you for having that show because the overflow came to the movies.
Oh, that's cool.
They were already downtown, so they might as well go to the movies.
Very cool.
But from that point on, we always had two shows, one at 5:30 and one at 9 o'clock.
Okay.
Because you turn away that many people.
So what? Who were some of the acts?
Well, the most popular act was that we ever had here was Paul Revere and the Raiders.
Okay.
I mean, they were just unbelievable. And I got a quick story about that.
Okay.
We had them booked to play here. I don't remember, it was 67 or 68, somewhere along in there. And I had the contract, everything was cool, and then all of a sudden I was notified that I didn't have a legitimate contract, that they were playing in Atlanta that day.
Oh no.
And that's exactly what I said. So I hop in a car and I drive to Atlanta to meet with Paul to let him know, and they were concerned that radio stations would say they were going to be coming and all that.
Promoting
just
it.
Right, just yeah. to get them there.
Oh, that's not cool.
And
yeah.
So anyway, I flew down there to talk. No, I mean, I drove down there to talk to them. And he said, well, let's see if we can figure something out because we're 100 miles away. Well, at the time, Mr. Benz's partner owned a Learjet International in Atlanta.
Nice.
And he rented out those small jet planes. And they had never flown in one.
The band?
Right. So he sent the road guy, whose name was Hoss, by the way, up to Chattanooga to bring all the equipment up there because they were already using promotional equipment there in Atlanta. So he sends all the equipment up here to set up. We arrange for the airplane and for escort service in Atlanta and escort service here. So they played in Atlanta at 3:30. They hopped on a plane, they flew up here and opened our show at 5:30.
Awesome. Rock stars.
They weren't scheduled to open the show. But when Paul came in, he said, let's so we get back, because they had another show in Atlanta at 8 o'clock.
Oh, wow.
So he said, let us just go on first. So, I mean.
Yeah, whatever you want.
You talk about bringing the house down. It was something
that's
else.
Awesome. Did you get to go on the jet with them?
No.
Tell me you did. Man.
No, yeah. I didn't.
What was the whole era like? Because everything was new.
It's different.
Right? I mean, rock and roll was new. These kinds of concerts were new.
Bands getting on jets. Radio,
all of that was new. What was that like?
Man. You have no idea. When you're going through something like that, you have no idea of what you're going through. It's fun. You love it.
Busy.
And it was just... It was an exciting time as far as I was concerned.
It's so different now. It's,
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have laws and stuff now.
Ugh. Authority. Who likes that?
Yeah, they do.
Ugh. Yeah, I mean, so that time, how long do you think that time really lasted when rock and roll and the radio business was like that and it was so exciting? You know, like, you say like a decade or two? What do you think?
Well, no, FLI enjoyed 20 years.
20 years.
From 1961 to 1980.
Mm-hmm.
And in 1980, KZ-106 came on the air, FM, and just blew FLI right out of the water. Mm-hmm. Well, Mr. Ben said, well, let's just go country. So we go country. DOD was the big station then, the country station.
Okay.
And FLI blew them out of the water. Well, they turned around and did their FM, and there went FLI again.
Yeah,
so
competition.
So when FM took over, that was
it.
That was it.
Cool story.
TJ, the DJ. The man. My close personal friend. Do we have you next?
It was nice to hear your stories. I wish I would have been here with you. Yeah. Wish I would have been around. I always say that. I would have done much better back then.
It was fun. It was fun.
Johnny, could you comment about the good old days when you won a case of beer? All you did was you'd pull up to the station. There was no IDs checked.
I love it.
And they would keep the beer, not a certificate for the beer. They would keep like 80 cases of beer in the side building. You pull up out front, and they would put the beer in the trunk.
Man.
The good old days.
What happened to that? Man. That's a great business right there.
Why aren't we doing that?
You guys gave it away. To get in to see Bobby Q Day, you had to bring him a suit. Which I did.
I like it.
I know. Yeah. It's the truth.
That's so fun.
Yeah. Bobby Q Day's
cool.
Well, when I started in radio, I started at a little radio station in Honolulu called KIKI.
Nice.
And I didn't know you couldn't do what you just got through saying. So I was a smoker then. I ran out of cigarettes. So there was a bunch of promotional records laying around, and I knew they were never going to play them. So I picked them up and said something on the air about I was out of cigarettes. If I'll give five records here for a pack of cigarettes. And this guy brought me cigarettes. I gave him the records, but I also gave away my job. That was my first.
Oh, no.
The owner of the station called up and said, "You can't do that. You're out of here." So,
but
that was after midnight, man. That was 3 o'clock in the morning.
I used to do that with cappuccino. Like when I worked at the radio station, I'd be like, "Whoever brings me a cappuccino," I'd be like behind there in the news area.
Since I brought it up, that's what Bobby Q did. On the radio would say, "You know, Ellis, you better bring me something to eat, or I'm telling your wife where you really are."
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you so much.
Good.
All right.
Bobby Q Day was on radio and
he
just started. So he plugged himself in after every record ever. Bobby Q Day.
Big Tommy.
Little lady.
Come on, Tommy.
Said, my boyfriend is here, everyone.
She said, "Come on, Tommy." It's all me. It's a Bobby Q Day, but you haven't told us.
All right. He's making his way. He got it.
TJ, that's not Tommy. The board in now.
Look out now.
Look out. That's right. He's coming.
Yep.
Right here by me. Yeah.
Barry.
You
got it?
There you go.
There we go.
He's here.
All right.
This is a celebrity. Make yourself comfortable. I got a bad knee, too. You're fine.
So everybody recognizes, I'm sure, Tommy Jett.
The rock star.
Head now. Fastest jet in the sky, right?
I still got a fastest jet in the air.
Yeah. Signed it on, is that right?
Huh?
Signed the station on?
Yeah, I was here when it was first on.
That's right out of school, right?
Well, I went to Waycross, Georgia. The school sent me down there for on the job training to a station called WAYX, Waycross, Georgia. And I was down there for about a month and a half, something like that. And I'd already been to school, so I pretty well knew.
Yeah.
You know, and I lived and breathed this. This wasn't a passing fad for me. This was my life. Matter of fact, I lived in a room back there for two years.
Really?
Yeah, I had an apartment.
Pay was that bad?
It didn't have a kitchen facility, so I had to eat all my meals out. But I was able to have restroom facilities and it had a little bedroom.
Were there some wild parties here?
Oh yeah.
Tell me there were.
Yeah. We had some wild ones.
I like the sound of that. I'm trying to dig these stories out.
Somebody, and I won't say who, Tommy, told me you used to carry a gun around with you.
I still do.
Better watch it.
He has a
I don't have it on today, but I carry a pistol everywhere I go.
Now, does the one you carry today actually work?
Because
the one back then didn't for a while.
No, they all
work. What is he doing?
Tommy, just leave it in your pocket.
Yeah, I believe you, Tommy.
Yeah, we believe you, Tommy.
You see, that's the problem. If you're afraid of something, that's where the danger is. If you know what you're doing, then you don't have to worry about anything.
Nobody's going to hurt you, Tommy.
Hey, Tommy.
Don't worry about it.
Can I tell you, did you know or suspect that you remember Larry Robinson?
Yeah, I remember Larry.
And you remember young Stanley?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you ever know that they got together one time and got one of your pistols? And when you would pull it out, you know, they became a little concerned, and they actually had the firing pin shaved off of that thing.
No, I didn't know that.
That's the story that came
from Larry Robinson.
That sounds like a made-up
story. No. Larry Robinson swears on a stack of Bible. Hey, so you sold a pistol that didn't fire.
I can make up stories that you wouldn't believe.
No way.
Maybe Larry will show up here in a few minutes.
Yeah.
Let's get this straightened out.
Do you have a favorite story from all of your time, or a few?
The favorite story was, I don't know, some of my favorite stories, I don't know if should be told.
We're live here, Tommy,
so kind of keep that in mind.
So, on the internet, you can kind of say whatever. Anything goes.
Well, Mr. B is, I love Mr. B. He was kind of a father figure to me, you know. And I was with him. Everybody would run when they'd see him coming because he had a disease. And it was alcohol. It was a drug disease, alcoholism. And I was on the air a lot.
At the time.
Ringo Van. What does it say Ringo gets into my part of this? I'm the one who got him started.
Of course you are.
He was a little boy out in the lobby. No. Anyway, a funny quick story, which I don't have any short stories, was Mr. B, he had a Cessna, one engine, you know, at the time, and he later moved to a two-engine job, but we had a couple of girls with us, and he was trying to impress the girls, you know, and we went up in an airplane, one engine at night, and we had both been drinking, and it wouldn't have mattered from whether I was drinking or not, because I couldn't have flown the plane. I couldn't have flown the plane anyway. And Mr. V had a drink or two.
Or 20. Yeah.
Whichever.
Whatever.
And we got ready to, we almost ran into Lookout Mountain. We had to do a dive.
Oh my gosh.
To keep from hitting the mountain. And from the air at night back then, do they have drive-in theaters now?
There's one down in the Trenton area.
I know about that one, but that's only, anyway, there were plenty of drive-in theaters. And we almost landed that airplane from the air, the lights that up and down, you know, the lights that run up and down looked similar to the lights you'd see if you were landing an airplane.
That is crazy.
Yeah. And we almost landed at the Broad Street Drive-In Theater.
That's awesome.
We buzzed it. And Mr. B, obviously, I don't think he became sober. But he realized he wasn't that drunk, and he realized what he was done, and we pulled back up and missed landing in the Broad Street Drive-In Theater.
So were the girls impressed, or were they terrified?
They didn't know what was going on.
They liked it.
They were with celebrities.
Rockstar lifestyle.
They thought that was normal.
Yeah, they thought that was normal.
Tommy, I asked.
I love that story. Thank you.
Johnny earlier, what was it like? Because all of this was so new. It's hard for us to imagine because, I mean, we've seen movies and televisions, but you guys were living it as it was happening.
And it's hard to get it in its proper perspective because actually, to me, A lot of guys didn't go to school to do this. I mean, there are some guys that just faked it and made it. I'm not degrading that, but I went 9 months to school from 6 to 10 at night, worked all day, and after we worked all day, we'd go We all lived in a boarding house.
Was it a radio broadcasting
school? Yeah, yeah, it was a radio broadcasting school. And we would have our evening meal, dinner, whatever you call it, and go to school from 6 to 10. From there, we'd hit radio stations. So I went to WLAC, WSM. I met Patsy Cline and Skeeter Davis.
You went to school to learn how to do the knobs and switches. I'm talking about rock and roll.
Yeah,
like excitement meeting Patsy Cline.
Well, I met these people.
Right.
I did shows out of the studio. I appeared at the Coat of Arms. Bill Hay owned a place on Brandon Road called the Coat of Arms. It was a team place.
Sure.
And that's where I got to know Jerry Lee Lewis and Ray Stevens.
Yeah, that's something we hadn't asked about. Is
cool.
Country stations still do it a little bit, but the artists used to travel the country.
Oh, yeah.
Knocking on you guys' doors,
exactly.
Right, to come in,
yeah,
to get you to play their stuff. So,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
it was a different time.
And, mm-hmm.
Right. And you know, I got to meet just about Little Richard, Fast Domino,
wow,
the Paddles, the Coasters, the Drifters.
Everybody but the one you wanted to meet, right?
Yeah.
Who's
yeah.
the one you wanted to meet?
Well, Elvis is in his
time.
I got to see him in person, and I got to know a lot of people that traveled with him and
the
knew
king.
Him. But I, yeah, the king.
Tommy's a big Elvis fan.
I'm a big Elvis fan, too.
Yeah.
Well, I used to wish he was still alive, but.
Well, there's nobody ever done what he did. And that's the same.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
Or moved like he did. Yeah. They try.
Yeah, they tried, but
mm-hmm.
nobody ever sold it, and that still holds true. Nobody sold as many records as he did, or has, and the movie thing.
Did you try to find him? Did you try to meet him?
No, this was in Auburn, Alabama, was where I went to see him, and I maybe if I'd worked harder at it, I know. Then what I know now,
right.
I could have pulled some strings.
It's the hardest when you really want to meet someone. I do this too,
exactly.
You meet all the people you're not trying to.
Yeah.
That's true. And eventually, you meet so many of the singers that they begin to respond like, you know, like we do this every day, or, you know, I know.
Right, it becomes like that.
You know, Billy Joe Royal was one of my closest friends. And we just lost him about a year ago.
Aww.
He passed away. And I had just talked to him about 3 days before he died. Mm-hmm. And he was at the Hall of Fame inductee thing for me. I invited him, and I didn't think he'd come. And he loved it. He
awesome.
Had a ball there. He signed some autographs, and, you know.
All right, so we're going to one more?
Yeah.
Can we get Ringo?
We'll
swap you out.
Your protege over here?
Yeah.
Ringo.
The young man.
Ringo man.
Okay, you guys. Well, I love your story.
Great job, Tommy. Great job, buddy.
Thank
great,
you.
Great. And Tommy, you didn't tell about Squirrel and Shirley.
No.
You
gotta tell the truth.
Be careful now. Don't trip her, Tommy.
Okay. Ringo man. This guy's interviewed me more than
I know. He's written about you too. I made him famous.
He did, really.
Famous or infamous?
Infamous.
You guys bear with us. We're just changing guests. You know how this goes. Very casual.
Okay, you're okay.
That was real.
Bye. Thank you so much.
Okay, so who's interviewing
nice
you?
Nice to see you.
Who's
we're all going to interview
Ringo Van.
Who knows?
We're going to get Van to sit down in a minute.
Oh, good. Save the best for last, Ben Kane.
Oh, yeah. Come on, guys. You don't need me in there.
That was fun.
What's your name?
I'm Leslie.
Hi, Leslie. I'm Rick Govan.
Nice
Ringo.
To meet you.
I was Ringo Van.
Ringo. Okay,
Ringo.
That's fun.
So we've got Johnny Eagle, Tommy, and now you. You guys were...
David Carroll.
David Carroll.
Good old David Carroll.
You guys were...
That's the dream team.
The dream team. The all-stars.
Tell you a story about David Carroll.
Yes.
Tell us one.
On a Sunday afternoon... David, if he were here, he'd tell you exactly the day and the year if he passes by.
I know. He's really good at that.
Okay. And I'm on the air Sunday afternoon. Rick Shaw, who was just here, Rick Sharp, was the engineer. And we had a contest. And this listener won and he won a record or a t-shirt or something, and his parents drove him up from Bessemer. Is that where he's from? Alabama? Somewhere down there, Scottsboro.
Yeah.
A young David Carroll.
Sand Mountain. He lived on Sand Mountain.
13,
somewhere.
14, 15 years old, comes walking in here.
Aww.
So we show him around the station. The kid would never leave. He was just sitting.
So
he has told that story before.
And then he went, about 2 years later, he went to work at my uncle's radio station in South Pittsburgh.
WEPG? I was there 2 days ago.
E.P. Govan.
Really?
It's named after my uncle, E.P. Govan. And David would, when he was in high school, would ride his motorcycle over the mountain to South Pittsburgh and work Sundays at WEPG.
With a leather jacket on?
Yeah, yeah.
Awesome.
And then I left in 69 and David came here and when did he say? 71, 2 or 3 or something. Yeah.
So one of the things I've come to learn is the radio and TV community here in Chattanooga is very, very close. I mean, you guys, well, you're all here, right? I don't know that everybody that's here today worked here, or maybe they did, but that's an unusual thing.
Yeah.
I'm told it's very unusual. I don't know. I don't have a perspective on it from other markets.
Yeah, usually separate.
But I'll tell you the reason why I think it is here, and you can credit David Carroll for that.
I think David
He is the guy that keeps, has been, and continues to bring us together. Gary Mack as well, and Ben Cagle, and Earl, those four guys. But David's been the kind of the leader of it, and those other Ben Cagle and Gary and it's kind of great. We used to be competitors.
That's what I brought up, and I've been fortunate to have been invited to a couple of the luncheons.
Yeah,
with you guys, it truly is remarkable.
And it's so stupid that we were serious competitors. Now we love each other.
It's like walking into a gathering of a liars club in a way. It's sort of one story after another, but everybody seems to really love each other.
But there's another element too. I think is Luther's presence in the community.
Used to get a standing ovation when he walked in, right?
But Luther was just so respected by everybody, and so it was.
What was it like working here?
Man, this was, I was telling Lori, my wife, the other day, this was the greatest experience that I ever remember. And I've had some good jobs, some great jobs after I left here. But I came here in college as a freshman in 1964 and heard about a weekend opening and got the job and then worked into full-time later. But it was like being in a... I was in two fraternities, one on campus at the university, then the University of Chattanooga, and one here at WFLI. And I was, at the time, I was the young guy, so they were playing tricks on me and all that kind of stuff. It was great. It was great.
And a lot of people don't get the opportunity to love their job. Some people don't know what that's like. Those jobs aren't always the ones that pay the most, but it is cool to work at I've worked at radio stations, too. It's fun.
For a college kid to work at a 50,000 watt number one rated radio station.
So cool.
And to participate in those Jet Fly spectaculars and meet those stars. And
who were some of your favorites to meet?
Well, the story I love to tell is about Lesley Dale.
My party.
Yeah, and Judy's Turn to Cry, and I heard her on the radio this morning. The Jet Fly Spectaculars, the DJs would introduce the different acts. So for whatever reason, I was to introduce Lesley Gore. And the way we did it was we would, once you'd introduce someone, you would go out there and then you would hand off and say, and then here's Tommy Jett. So you kind of introduce the next DJ that would come out.
Okay.
So after I introduced Lesley Gore and she sang her set of songs, I went back out to thank her and then introduce whoever the next DJ was to introduce the next act. And as she was walking off, I said, because at the time she was a student at a college in New England somewhere. I've forgotten which college, Smith College or something. And so she's walking off, and I said, Lesley, come back. And Johnny Eagles, go there. And I said, come back. And I said, I've got a question for you. She didn't know what I was going to ask her. She had no idea. And Johnny's going crazy. Come on, Ringo, get her off. Come on. And I said, Lesley, I'm a part-time disc jockey at WFLI, trying to work my way through college, and I'm barely making C's and D's. And you're a full-time artist. You've got the number one record. You're touring, and I just read where you're on the dean's list at whatever college it was. I said, how do you do it? And she looked at me, and she looked out at the audience, and she looked back at me, and she said, well, Ringo, I guess I just know my professors a little better than you.
I was going to say. I already knew the answer.
Yeah.
I don't know how.
Yeah.
Did that advice help you any?
Yeah. No.
I know, because
she was sharp.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's a Lesley thing.
There you go. Okay.
I've been with Tommy and some of the others when people have come up and said, I grew up listening to you. What you did meant. What is that like for you? I know you hear that.
It is absolutely amazing. I was here for 5 years. By the way, my car has my license tag says JetFly.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Awesome.
But people still today will come up to me and say, Ringo.
I love
still
that.
Still today. Still
Isn't
today.
It amazing?
50 years. 50
yeah.
years.
It's just, it's it happens. Once or twice a month.
It's a good feeling,
right? It's absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
I've heard radio people say that they really appreciate, because to turn that radio on, you're letting somebody into your house.
Yeah.
So there is that kind of connection. Yeah. So
definitely.
You feel it. Yeah.
You feel like you know them. I have some favorite radio. You want me to tell you mine? I love Howard Stern. So if anything ever happened to him, I would feel like I lost like a friend.
Right.
Honestly. Yeah, nothing happened.
I get it.
But that's the way people felt about Johnny Carson. You know, it's that same.
Sure, Luther for sure.
And, yeah,
I mean, yeah, that exactly. Was every day. So, and you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the reality is there wasn't nearly as much competition.
I know it's crazy
back
now.
Then as there
and now
is
there's
now.
Sirius.
A lot more
and
stations and Sirius and we were powerful with 50,000 watts. And,
yep.
And we played great music and had some great DJs and good management. Johnny Eagle was a fantastic manager.
No, I miss like the great radio, radio stations.
Yeah.
Not all the talking.
The local people.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate what you guys are doing.
It's been so fun.
Thank you for what you're doing.
We're having a ball.
So it seems like a celebratory day, not
Bill
a sad
Miller.
Day.
Yeah. Bill
definitely.
Miller.
Definitely.
Bill Miller.
Good.
Barry.
Pleasure to meet you.
Come in. Hey, Brandon,
thank
come
you.
In.
Nice
Bill was right in the middle
you.
Of this year.
Hey, Rick,
I was
a mere lamb.
So what day was it that you came in here for your birthday? You won the, and I was on the air.
Oh, that's true. When I was 11, he gave me a record.
Really?
It's a live camera. We're live right now.
Old.
You want to sit in my left chair there?
Sure.
Your record, you earned yourself.
Here we go.
Your name is?
I'm Leslie.
Leslie, I'm Bill.
Nice to meet you.
Too.
That's the truth.
I'm liking that Leslie Gore story. I think she spelled it the same way I do, too.
W-S-L-E-Y?
E-Y, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
I miss the Leslie Gore story.
Oh, it was a
good
one.
She passed away.
Yes, she has.
About a year ago?
Yeah.
Cool lady, it sounds like.
I'm going to tell one story.
Yeah, tell us a story.
I've got two, but one is a little off color. I'm going to call them ladies.
That's the one we want.
That's what we want.
Who are you?
I'm
made that
back.
Very clear.
Yeah, tell us who you are and when you were here.
Okay, I'm Bill Miller. I came here in December 1968. I was 18 years old. And it was.
What's going on?
It was very, very much culture shock. Tommy Jett.
What'd you leave, Tommy?
Yeah.
This?
Yeah.
What is it?
It's I'll tell you what it is.
Confidential document?
It's a pulse ratings.
Okay. Ratings?
Ratings.
Yeah. I don't want anything to do with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Tommy.
You do one of these.
I do? Yeah. I'll take your word for it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
But,
everything Bill Miller says is true.
Okay.
That's right. My integrity is
perfect.
We're on the air, TJ.
All right.
Here we go. We're on the air.
Okay. There was a character that a lot of people will remember, but not your younger audience. J. Basil Maul.
J. what?
J. Basil Maul.
Okay.
You missed a
name.
Basil Maul.
J. Baz was a preacher. He had a TV show. He promoted concerts all over the South and in Cincinnati and Midwest. And he was based out of Knoxville, Tennessee. Died a few years ago, and Jay Basil was blind. You know Jay Basil. You remember Jay Basil, right?
Yeah.
And Jay Basil had I think it was an hour-long show here on Sunday mornings. And he would come in about every 3 weeks. and record the shows and promote his concerts at Memorial Auditorium. Johnny usually recorded it. I was hoping Johnny would be hanging around here. And so I'm 18 or 19 and I'm on the air, and I'm a little intimidated by being here anyway. At that point in my life, in this big rock and roll atmosphere, Tommy Jett's 28 years old, leading me astray.
Oh, I love it.
And Jay Basil came in, and he had a gravelly voice, and he said, Brother Bill, Johnny said it was okay if I came in and promoted the show down at the auditorium.
Yeah.
And I knew that was wrong. He couldn't do that. It was the afternoon drive, and he stood right there, and there was a big cart rack here. And I said, well, give me just a minute, Jay Bass. And we were playing records then, 45 vinyl, and I started Sweet Caroline
by
Neil Diamond.
Love it.
Da da da, da 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 da. And I introed it and said something over the beginning. And then I turned the monitor down, which was right here on the old board. Unbeknownst to me, Jay Basil had walked around and was over my shoulder. And remember, he's blind. And he's a bit of a shyster, too.
Oh.
I liked him, but he was a bit of a shyster. I turned the monitor down, and so he was under the impression, I did not mislead him, he just jumped to the conclusion that we were on the air. And I said, here's Neil Diamond, Sweet Caroline. I turned it down, and all of a sudden, Jay Basil says, well, thank you, Brother Bill. This weekend, we've got the impressions coming down the auditorium. And so I let him talk. And this Sweet Caroline was a little less than 3 minutes long. Is a little less than 3 months long. And I caught on and wised up. And just as I got near the end, I said, well, thank you, Jay Basil. We'll all look forward to that show. Thank you, Brother Bill. That's Neil Diamond. And Jay Basil was happy, and Johnny was happy because I didn't interrupt the music, the rock and roll music.
Cool.
But the other show, it's something I wouldn't say in front of my mother, bless her heart. It's not
Go
too bad.
For it.
Jay Basil came in and he did his TV show and all of his shows with his wife.
Oh.
Ms. Mo. Jump in here if you guys can add anything. And there was a minor bird out here.
A what?
A minor bird, right? It was a minor bird.
Yeah, a cage.
Minor bird. And it was out here in a cage, and it had only been here a few weeks. It was only here for a few weeks while I was here, and then it was gone. But it had been here for a long time. And the story goes that they came in one day to record the show, and somebody, probably Bud Bell, was teaching the minor bird some socially unacceptable language. So the moles walked in and...
Off color.
Off
color.
Is it too off color?
No. Okay.
And the minor bird says, the minor bird had a name. But anyway,
so
minor bird said, all of a sudden, goes, some bitch! some bitch! And Jay Basil said, now, Miss Mo! No, he said, first he said, hey there, there's a little bird. And that's when the bird said, some bitch! What did he say, Miss Mo? Oh, never mind, Jay Basil. And she brought him on in, and the minor bird disappeared the next day.
He was
taken away.
He sounds fun.
Yeah. Yeah, he was.
The bird got censored. That's funny.
But that's funny. It. And
I'm sure there's many.
Did you ever have to clean up after the lion that was out front in the lobby?
The lion preceded me.
A live lion.
I had to clean up a couple of disc jockeys.
And they kept it here, and they had to clean up after it.
Why were all these animals in the lobby?
I don't know.
Mascot.
Did anyone tell the lion story? Because I don't know.
No, tell it. Tell it.
I don't know enough about it. There was a pet lion here at one time.
We need Johnny.
Johnny. Where's Johnny?
Recall Johnny for the lion story. There was a pet lion, a station mascot, which was really was a lion.
Who lives here?
Well, I can tell
who lives here. A lion lived in the lobby. That's interesting.
Now we're given the impression this was like Animal House.
This was like Animal House.
Where are you?
On the money.
You're getting thumbs up.
There are holes in the ceiling.
I've seen them. Yeah. Weren't supposed to ask about those. I'd love to know.
Yeah. Put there by the owner.
Potential felonies were involved.
Somebody should have done, back then there wasn't reality TV, but this would have been a great reality TV show.
WKRP came pretty close.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I was going to ask Tommy about the, we got a bomb threat.
Yeah,
and so,
more than one.
Yeah, and so they evacuate the building. Well, they forgot to tell Tommy about the bomb threat. So Tommy's living in the back in here, and he sticks his head out the door and says, "What's going on?" They're all evacuated. Well, no one remembered to go get Tommy up out of the bed.
He made it.
That's a true story.
Is Johnny coming in to tell the lion story?
I'll step away.
All right.
Everything else, either the statute of limitations or not, statute of limitations.
Or, we appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much.
Fun.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Maybe we can scoot over. Just let him tell it from right there.
Okay.
Yeah, that'll work.
That'll probably be.
All right, Tommy.
Tommy's back.
Share the lion story from where you are.
All right, dump it out.
We won't make
here
you
Here we
sit.
Go, right here. That way you don't have to get back across.
How long was the lion here, Tommy?
She was here.
She. I like that.
Yeah, it's a lion. It was a lioness, really. And Dale saw the piece on the AP.
Cool.
And he thought, you know, DXB had one years ago. And so he suggested we get a lion. So Billy Warren drove a Ford that we were giving away, a 55 Ford car that the disc jockeys had all written WFLI on it, and we were going to use her to take her to the schools. So they put a partition in the back of the car so get the line in there. But Billy drove all the way to Birmingham to pick her up and brought her back home, and Mr. Benz insisted that we have her in the lobby and cleaning up lion do.
Now, can you imagine in today's world,
like
you see an advertisement, and it says lion for sale,
yeah,
and it was in Birmingham.
Yeah, yeah.
And right. JetFly went down there, picked up the lion, paid the price, wrote the check, and bring the lion back. Nothing. Doesn't clear anything with any animal officers or anything.
No.
And the lion, the live lion, stayed out here for how long?
Probably 6 months or a year.
I thought it was longer than that.
You said, can you imagine in today? I'm not sure that was a good idea then.
Let's go get a lion. That would have been advisable.
It was up to all the disc jockeys had to clean the cage. We took turns doing
that's part of your role.
And
the owner
of the station, and you correct me if I'm wrong, Billy Benz would go to the store and buy some hamburger meat.
Right.
And put the hamburger, and he would put the lion in the back of the car. And this came from Johnny Eagle. Johnny, you tell me if I'm right. He would put the hamburger meat behind the seat of whoever was in the car with him. And the lion would reach around to try to get the hamburger meat.
She
would freak out whoever was in there.
She was very protective when it came to food. She was a pet. Otherwise, she hated dogs. But I have a picture of her in the field out there. In front, but she didn't like dogs, and I saw a dog try to jump through our windows out there trying to get away from her.
So all of you radio guys couldn't tame the woman lion.
No, right? No, we couldn't.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Eventually had her declawed, declawed, defanged. Everything.
But pooped every 2 hours.
Pooped every 2 hours.
But yeah, you want to talk about pooping?
Not really.
Wait a minute.
This
took a turn.
Of the world.
You talking about the bird?
Was the minor bird.
That was my idea. Yeah.
Well, Tommy, that wasn't a good idea. I wouldn't be claiming that.
Did you tell him about the time that you nearly committed yourself to Moccasin Bend?
Oh my God. You didn't tell him about that?
Did you tell
him
about
Johnny,
this?
Come over here, Johnny. Come here.
Sit down here.
We've got to tell him about the time. This really
I love
it. Tommy, am I telling the truth about what's going on? You know what I'm going to talk about. Tommy called Mr. Benz and says, I'm going to have to check myself in to a mental institution.
Okay.
And Mr. Benz says, what do you mean?
Oh, yeah.
And he says, I'm losing it. I'm sorry, but I'm losing it. And he was about to go to pieces.
Yeah.
Johnny?
Well,
Johnny can't tell this.
You tell us if he's telling
the story. He's the one that initiated the story.
What was going on in here?
Well, Tommy was on the air.
Yeah.
Tommy come in on the air, and Tommy's got blinders on. I don't know if anybody's ever noticed that or not, but he's got blinders on.
Okay.
Because he's the only man I've ever known that can get from Red Bank to over here to the radio station and never cross the Tennessee River.
It's a talent.
So
yeah.
So he's got blinders on. Anyway, Tommy would be on the air, and me and young Stanley was doing production over into the production room at that time. That speaker right up there don't work anymore, but it what was going on in the production room, we found out, would bleed over just slightly in the background.
You thought you were hearing voices?
Yeah.
So that's scary.
His favorite station was a WKDA, I think, in Nashville.
Yeah, well, it was KDA.
Every time it was time for a break or something, and when Tommy would shut up, then we'd play. We'd hit the
WKDA.
Yeah.
Oh.
On the air, and see, he could hear it up here, but nobody. And he'd call people in here, and say, he'd call me in here and say, "Do you hear that?" I said, "I don't hear nothing, Tommy."
The whole station was in on it. The whole station. The secretaries were in on it. It went on for weeks. It went on for weeks.
You got the staff fired over there.
He calls up Mr. Ben, says, I got to quit.
Mr. Ben, I'm losing it.
Tommy hadn't been right since.
You go get it fixed. And they got fixed. Immediately.
Well, I'm glad the voices happened.
Let me finish this off, because this is important.
Okay. I'm listening.
The power of suggestion is phenomenal, really.
Definitely.
And if enough people tell you something, you can find a psychiatrist or psychologist that'll tell you that this works. If enough people tell you something and
tell you long enough, Tommy.
Yeah, tell you long
enough. You guys, look what you did.
Yeah. And I was calling people in, they weren't hearing it. But I was.
Yeah.
And really, I was hearing it. They were hearing it too. But they, like Johnny said, they had it rigged the way where it would play in here, and long story short, it got out of hand.
Do you hear any voices these days?
No, I don't hear.
No, I do.
So I listen to Mr. Ben.
Just his own.
I told him, I gotta have some.
You got that right.
And I was getting ready to, do it all.
We're glad you made it.
Yeah, so
we got through it, Tommy.
He said, "We'll fix it." And
There's no more voices.
No more. All
right. Not right now.
Are we going to wrap it up?
Yeah, I guess so. Thank you, Tommy.
Here, so thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody,
for sharing these stories.
Tommy, love you.
Love you too, brother. All right, next time, Glory. Next time, Grace gets up here.
We'll do it.
Bye, you guys.
So we've been what?
Animals, rock stars,
bottle caps,
stories,
the asphalt, minor birds.
And these guys are really the characters here. You know,
these guys were the stars. Firing cans that have been shaved off that really were shaved off.
They didn't work.
They really were.
Why don't we have this much fun?
Well, there's some stories from the paper.
We have a few.
None of these guys went to jail.
So, but the guy who's been talking kind of behind is Ben Cagle. Ben has been very gracious and helpful in putting all this together.
Thank you, guys.
Come
it's
over.
A fun day.
You want to say anything?
It was a party. I guess the number one thing that people keep asking is, what was it like? And all I can say is it was magic.
Yeah.
I mean, it was pure magic. It's kind of like the Beatle invasion of 64. People say they understand, that looked big. That was big.
Mm-hmm.
But unless you experience that, then you do not know the magic.
Yeah.
And when I was in high school, I came in here one night, and the guy that was on duty said, hey, you want to sit down? You want to give it a shot?
Mm-hmm.
And I sat there for a few hours and wound up at 3:00 in the morning. I said, oh my God, my dad's going to kill me.
Mm-hmm.
And the pure magic, I was hooked forever.
Yeah.
From that moment on of being in radio and TV. So it's been a great ride for me. I love it. I love these guys, every single one of them. It would be impossible to tell you how much I love them. I love every single one of them. The ones that I even didn't work with. It's a fraternity, really, that it's very hard to describe. Yeah. I love every single one of them.
I've been fortunate to see it with you guys, so it's very meaningful.
Well, we
it's
appreciate nice. You and informing folks about what we're doing. It means a lot to them.
Switches.
Means a lot to
this
us.
Was
really.
Got to sign off soon, right? How many more times are you going to have to do this
this
today?
This is the last
one. This is the last one.
We've got one more hour of hard rock and roll here.
Oh, good.
And we're going to go to 4 o'clock.
This is it.
All right, well, let's get the last...
I forgot about that. I thought he was... Gonna switch to preachers already.
No, not yet.
We got another hour.
I think the preachers
had one person calls it. What happened? Are you guys gonna sign off now?
I want to try getting Max on here.
Well, sure. Yeah,
I would love to get Max on here if we could.
Definitely.
If that's possible.
That night, you thought nobody else in the world cared about you, or even everybody's looking.
Yeah, we can. Max is good.
Time of day, man, but you could always look up in the sky. And you know, TJ,
what is that?
That is Roger Allen Wade. Are you familiar with Roger Allen?
Yes.
He loves this station on a scale you can't even imagine.
Cool.
Who would have known?
Oh, yeah.
We've got people who want that Jetfly song.
He's written songs about Jetfly. Have you heard any of it?
Yeah.
A little bit from
Here's the song.
People commenting on our Facebook page. They want that song.
That makes a little comedy.
Here's one of them. Buddy Brainerd Road was hot back then. Let me know. Here we go. Right here. It's just a, even if you're not in the biz, if you were here, you felt attached to it.
Yeah.
You
know? The time was better.
Really. But now this guy came in a little bit later, but he would watch Tommy and the guy Johnny in here, and he was talking earlier. He put his nose right up against that glass.
I'd stand there and watch
before he went to the Chattanooga Police Department.
I'm Johnny Eagle.
And he said,
County.
Never worked for the county. I'm sorry, I told that wrong twice. I learned it. I knew that, but it came out wrong.
Max, when did you start?
I started in radio in 70.
Yeah, I think I remember.
I came here in 75 or 76.
But he did a great job. He just blended right in with the group. He said, that's what I want to do. That's all he wanted to do.
I was sitting right there.
Israeli and Arab forces battle. The Six-Day War ended with Israel occupying the Sinai Peninsula.
Son, it went crazy.
Gaza Strip and the East Bank of the Suez Canal.
We started playing Elvis music.
China
and we got a great vision of its car. I don't remember what radio station got it.
Marshall,
we had people walking around his radio Supreme station in a line for 3 days.
It was big.
Well, you know, you're talking about the newspapers. Mr. Roy McDonald printed the second edition and drove them to Memphis. Sold out of the
fearless boy. It was one of the largest in Chattanooga's in the nation.
So you came a little bit late.
Yeah. Well, I worked at DXB and GOW, and then I came here. So I'm not the rest of them. I've worked at all of them.
That's they're kind of like cooks and chefs here.
Yeah.
Seems like you could get fired here and have a job.
And it's the same thing, different flavors. That's all.
Yeah. Or come back in a month and get the job back here.
Or just walk in and tell the boss, you didn't fire me.
Yeah.
Must have been somebody else you fired.
We need to turn Aretha down. How do we do it, Alice?
Let's go in there.
Yeah, okay. I'll follow you guys.
That's good. Yeah, we got to get Max on
this way.
It's like Ron said.
Where are we here? Describe this room.
This is the production room.
This is the original WFLI production room.
So
and
cool.
It's just like it was.
Get a little of this sound out of here.
Thanks.
This room is just like it was the day I left.
Really? Really? When was that?
About 77.
Back in 77.
When I went into law enforcement.
I think we did a story together when you were in law enforcement, by the way.
You do what now?
I think we did a story together when you were in law enforcement.
May have.
Mm-hmm. I think you drove me around.
So walk us through, some of these controls look very cool. So walk us through what we're looking at here.
Reel to reel, to carts, to turntables.
Used to.
It's kind of a history here.
Yeah.
Used to, when we did production, it was all done on tape. The way we edited was you run the tape through here, you mark it with a grease pencil, you spliced it, you put splicing tape on. Took forever.
I know, yeah.
And it's not the little miter, right. That's for a razor blade, right?
Right. You take a razor blade,
crazy.
Tape it back together. And then they were placed on the cart machines.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's those old commercials.
That's so cool. That's crazy.
These are 1960 model boards. One of the original Gateway consoles.
They're gorgeous, though, I think. That's why I want something to happen with all of this stuff. And I feel like it should be somewhere for people to see.
We call this the WFLI Museum.
Really?
Yeah. I mean,
that's what it is. It's a museum. Radio's not like this anymore.
No, somebody has to do something with this
stuff.
You want
to talk about what that is for our younger
Well, we call it a cart. Now, it's very much like a 8-track player, except that the drive wheel is not in here. The drive wheel is in the machine, and as you raise it, you can see this little wheel come up and engage the tape. Every commercial and every song was placed on tape when I worked here. We played 45s for a little while, and then we started putting everything on the carts.
Yeah. So cool.
So you didn't have to queue those up. They queued automatically.
Awesome.
They didn't get stuck or skip.
No, they didn't. No. If you had one skip, you were in trouble with those. of course,
look at that
now
microphone.
Everything's computerized and radio. Oh. Everything's had a computer.
Yeah, the guy talking is 800 miles away, probably.
But I was, the day Elvis died, I was sitting across the hall doing an afternoon drive, and my newsman called me on the intercom and said, "We need to break into this song." Well, top 40 radio station, we just don't break into song, you know. Our business was music. I said, "We're not going to break into the music." He said, "Well, we probably need to on this." They said, "They're saying Elvis was just found dead." And I said, "Oh my God." So we broke into the song, and my newsman read the AP bulletin from the AP saying that Elvis had just been found dead and was being loaded to be taken to the hospital, but they didn't, you know, he wasn't going to live. So. But it was, I got off at 6 that day. I got off an hour early and I came in here and I started putting a montage together. We had a 9-minute montage of Elvis songs. We played that for several days. We went and got a huge card, and I don't know who furnished that card, but it was a sympathy card. And we asked people to come by and sign the sympathy card if that's what they wanted to do. And we had a line around the radio station for about 3 days. I mean, it was wrapped all the way around the building. People coming by and signing a sympathy card. And if I'm not mistaken, that was sent to Elvis's daughter, Priscilla. Mm-hmm. No, that was his wife.
Lisa Marie.
Lisa Marie, yeah. You'd think I'd be able
to remember. Me too. What am I thinking?
But, they got the card and everything. But it was that's probably one of the biggest things I remember while I was here.
Yeah,
that was a big deal.
Huge,
was
huge.
When were you guys playing Elvis a lot at the time? You were a top 40
right,
station.
Right, yeah. We played a lot of Elvis. And, of course, Mr. Benz, the owner, he loved Elvis.
I love this Mr. Benz character.
He would walk in
there. I wish
I would
have been able to meet him.
He'd walk in there and he'd say, this is my radio station. I played more Elvis.
Golden rule, right?
Yeah, yeah.
He who has the
gold. You sign in the checks, we'll play more Elvis.
He who has the gold.
Yep.
So, I know David Carroll has written a book about all this, but has he written a... It would be a good idea for someone to write a book about everything we've heard about today. Like the cast of characters. Maybe I should. Maybe we should do that.
We should do that.
We should start researching more. No, yeah. There's lots of material.
I know we just scratched
the surface, for sure.
Yeah, and I think... I'm kind of melancholy today because it was so much of my youth. I was like you.
Yeah.
I remember
we're
seeing
just losing
the
big
spotlights
a big hunk of our youth.
And I think that's one of the reasons
really, if you look at the situation of Jett Fly and so many people, I have no idea how many people have contacted me on this thing. And they're upset.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are looking at this as, well, wait a minute, it's going off the air. It's how many years? Wait a minute, let me figure these up.
Yeah.
And it's reminding people in a way of their own mortality.
Yeah, it's a lifetime of memories for us. And it's not just the fact that I worked here. It's the fact that I grew up with this radio.
Yeah, and like I said a while ago, it's nothing. It's pure magic. It was just the magic. But to realize that it's gone, that...
Let's kind of, I'm sure there's people wondering. So the Jett Fly that we've been talking about, the rock and roll Jett Fly, has been off from
since 81.
Yeah.
So it's been country and gospel. It's been gospel here for the last little bit. So what's happening today is the station itself is just going dark, right?
Right.
I mean, that's
right.
They're literally turning it off.
Yeah.
So there'll be nothing. So
I think they're going to put a couple religious shows back on, and then at 7 o'clock, shut it down. And the mere thought of closing the station is upsetting to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Well, it's like somebody passing on. It's just.
It's not that they still listen. It's the mere fact they don't like the fact
that
the transmitter is going
over
there.
It's over.
It's over. It's an admission that it's the end of an era. Really.
And the call letter.
And the call letter.
Yeah. Is there a chance that this becomes a radio station again? And if so, would it be FLI?
You want my opinion? This station is on the ropes, but it's not on the floor.
Mm. I'd love to see somebody
not on the floor.
Let's do it, baby.
If it did, would it be FLI?
It could be. If they want, it'll depend on if someone were to come in and buy the station. It would be. Of course, they have 365 days technically. Mm-hmm. That's the way the rules
for
were.
The
I think that's still the case. So within a year, and they could also pick up the same call letter. The call letters are with the station
until
it's completely gone. After 365 days, the way I understand it, the way I read it, unless it's been changed, there's 1 year that it can be revived.
Somebody do it. Come on.
Well, I'll tell you what I did this morning is I bought a $2 lottery ticket.
Yeah.
So that I can buy it.
So the Kickstarter fund has begun.
Fingers crossed.
Team I'm hiring right here.
Yeah.
I'm going to pay him about as much as he paid me in 1964.
Oh, you guys shouldn't make a lot of money. I made all kinds of money and had a gas trade and all the records I could take home.
And the management didn't know anything about it.
They knew about everything but the promo records.
What do you think Mr. Benz would think about today?
That's a good question. I don't know.
I think he'd be sad. I really
Johnny,
do.
You knew Mr. Benz. What do you think?
It was his life.
He'd probably be sad that it had to happen this way, but knowing his agility, he'd probably find a way to keep it on the air.
Yeah.
Yeah. He sounds really cool.
Yeah. Because I know he worked too hard to get this thing on the air.
Yeah.
People were amazed. I mean, you've heard the story. The people at WDXB hired the big engineers out of Chicago. They came in here, and WDXB at the time was it DXB or French, the French station.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He hired two engineers out of Chicago. They came in here. They spent 2 weeks, 3 weeks, did the research. They checked all over, and I don't know what he paid them. I'm told it was a lot of money. And after all that research, they did frequency analysis of the whole area. They came back and they said, there's no way. There's no way that you can increase your power. Because they tried every different angle.
What were they, 5,000?
No, they were 1,000.
They were one.
They were 1,000.
Yeah.
And so, so he gave up. Well, in the meantime, here comes Billy Benz in here and says, okay, maybe it won't work for Chattanooga. Maybe there's a spot in the outer areas, and maybe we can kick that thing in at 10,000 watts originally. And that's exactly what happened. That's what happened.
Awesome.
And it was to the amazement of, I mean, people were like dumbfounded in the business. They were totally dumbfounded. How can that happen? How can these other guys have all these engineers in here, and this guy from Alabama comes in and figures out a way, and he got the permit?
It's because he cared the most.
He thought outside.
And he was brilliant.
Cool.
He was a brilliant.
So how did we, with the transmitter here on O'Grady Drive in Tiftonia,
get licensed to look out?
How did we get licensed to look out?
I've wondered about
that. Part of the thing, I don't know. It happened.
You know, Johnny?
Yeah. Because, see, Lookout Mountain was incorporated at that time. Okay, Chattanooga, there wasn't room for another radio station in Chattanooga.
Yeah.
So that's how he figured out to take it outside of Chattanooga, and the Lookout Mountain was eligible.
Unserved community.
Yep.
Is Lookout Mountain considered separate from Chattanooga, though?
It was then.
I don't understand is how the transmitter could be here and be licensed to Lookout Mountain. This was the county, though, back then.
Right.
But
this wasn't in the city.
This
wasn't in the city. In fact, during that time, though, it didn't matter where your transmitter was.
Oh.
It didn't matter.
It
was the community you could serve. Now, if you'd have put it in South Pittsburgh, they might have had a problem.
Yeah.
Because you're not serving Chattanooga.
My uncle had a problem.
Lookout Mountain. Yeah, right. So,
unless I have any questions.
Yeah, I wanted to know. I know we've taken up a lot of y'all's time, but we had a ton of comments, people saying into the air, it's great to see everybody. People are loving all the stories. But Janice Johnson says, I remember the day they came on air in 1961 and Angel Baby was played. Anybody remember Angel Baby?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So you've got other people who are remembering some of those original memories, which is really nice.
Yeah. Have y'all seen that 50,000 watt home-built transmitter?
Oh, the transmitter?
In the back?
Yeah. Should we go see
water
that?
Water-cooled. Yeah.
And those of you that are tuned in there, I just want to say thank you. All these years for your support, it means a lot to us. This station would have never done anything, you know, without you.
Well, I will.
Without you guys.
You're talking about DXB being 1,000 watts. I will attribute a famous line to Dale Anthony, because they were bragging something about being 1,000 watts, and he said this on the air somewhere. I'm not exactly sure of the wordage, but the long story short was, he said, I have a hairdryer at home, it's got 1,000 watts.
Well, that sounds like Dale Anthony.
And here's the thing about it, when Mr. Benz knew that he was going to get the permit, he knew, he was so confident, and you correct me if I'm wrong, he was laying the foundation here of this building
before he
got the actual permit.
That's confidence.
And this is another story, and you correct me if I'm wrong. French, the guy that owned the other radio station occasionally, him and Jerry Lingerfeld, who wound up at Channel 9, retired from Channel 9, they would come by. This is my understanding. And French would make the comment, no way in hell it's going to work. No way in hell. And the foundation is going up at the top. And they would actually drive by here and look at the foundation going up. That's how confident that Mr. Ben was that this thing was going to go.
I like
Jerry
it.
Tells us.
Bold.
I'll provide you one more story behind that one. And that was that before he was granted the license for 10,000 watts, he had already an application, and it was filed with the FCC for 50. And that was granted in 1965, and we went on the air with 50,000 watts in 1968.
Wow.
He was a genius.
He
was so far ahead of his time, it just still blows me away today.
Very cool.
Total genius.
Lucky to have
Thank
him.
You all for yeah. coming out.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you,
thank
guys
you guys
so much
you.
For your time. Boy, your business has changed, hasn't it?
Yes.
Look at this.
Yes,
look what we're doing. Yeah.
I know.
It's amazing.
But, I know.
And Barry, thank you.
It's
Barry,
wonderful.
For all that you've done to help us. We really appreciate
that's
you guys.
Nice
all of
you
guys down there.
Very
all
nice
of you
to
folks.
Meet all of you. This was such a pleasure for, I think, everybody today. And you guys are going to go out with some rock and roll. Is that the understanding?
It's going on right
you
now,
guys
right?
Well, we got
right
the rock and roll going
I think
now.
We just... What do you think, Johnny? Let's just take over the radio.
I think that at 4 o'clock,
lock the doors.
Rock and roll stops.
Hey.
And I think there were a couple of paid... religious programs
that
are going to come back in for a couple
that
of hours.
If we so got
took over the radio.
Pirate radio.
The DJs that were here locked the doors, and then we went on the air live.
I wasn't insinuating
that all over again.
I think you just started something.
That would be so good.
Wait a minute. Is the judge still here? We better get him back.
Yeah. That would be so cool. What a story that would be.
Yeah, I mean,
the old
just
DJs
saying.
Locked everybody out, and they went live.
Okay.
Boy, that'd be cool.
All right, well.
Thanks again for all you folks.
Even more cool
with the time.
Turn on the mic.
You said all you got.
And all of a sudden,
well, I don't want to leave. I don't want to see this go like many of you don't either. But I guess I guess.
Oh, we don't either.
I know. Well, this will live on forever, this broadcast, so
it will.
If you're feeling lonely, the memories just go
will
back
be here.
And
the memories will always be here.
Yeah,
yes, they will.
Definitely.
Thank
well, you guys
you.
Have done
guys.
A great job. So, thank you so much.
Educate me. Where's the camera?
This
That's
is a camera. You guys can't see it. We need to be able to show them. This is the mic.
Okay.
So we talk about this camera a lot.
It's so cool.
I know. It's so seeing this equipment from seeing this equipment,
yeah,
and I wish we could
really
show
cool.
it to you guys. But yeah, this is where everyone's evolving.
Oh, this is
wow.
So that's the camera and the mic. He's controlling it with the iPad.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
This is Facebook Live.
Giving all my secrets away.
It's worldwide.
It's a little different from analog, Ringo.
Yeah. And it'll be different, you know, 50 years from now.
Some of that will be posted on your site.
Oh, yes, sir.
So, yes.
So we can all go home
it
and watch it.
Lives
cry.
Forever.
It
there you go.
Yeah.
We don't want to cry in public.
I know, I almost cried. Okay, we have to go. We're going to go listen to some music, though, right? Let's go listen to some music. You guys can listen, too. Okay. Bye.